Let's go to the Word tonight. Thank you for listening to Pastor Ramble On. At some point, we've got this weekend with Brother Stone King, but at some point, I know you've seen a couple of video clips from Sunday, but Pastor will put some of that together, and we'll try to just give you a little summary of Madagascar in some kind of more organized way. Thank you for the privilege of representing you there. Let's pray one more time. Lord Jesus, would you please just step in here by your presence, and would you illuminate the word in our hearts tonight? I thank you, God, for your word that we have such confidence in and that it has such meaning to us. But God, would you let the words kind of jump off the page tonight and light up in our spirit and help us and teach us, and we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen. Amen. How many have noticed that we're building something out there? Anybody noticed? Good. I'm sorry that we made you walk the long way around tonight. I know that's kind of a pain in the neck, and that's a little difficult, but it'll be cleared up before too many more days. They're pouring the foundation walls for the new entryway, and it's going to look really, really sharp when we're done. I want to talk to you about building tonight, and I want to go to the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7. And Jesus is teaching. This is his longest sermon. And in the final chapter, Matthew 5, 6, 7, in the final chapter of his sermon, the longest sermon Jesus preaches, he heads into this. And it's really kind of a neat thing. A lot of people think that Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he's comparing disciples and sinners. And you'll see what I mean in a minute. But he's not talking to his disciples comparing disciples and sinners. He's talking to his disciples, and he's actually comparing two different kinds of disciples. And so that's really important to notice at the beginning. He's not saying, disciples, here's how a disciple lives, and here's how a sinner lives. What he's doing is he's saying, here's how a disciple lives that's going to grow and flourish, and here's how a disciple lives that's going to fail and probably end up backslidden. And so that comparison is really important for all of us. So here we go. Matthew chapter 7. We've jumped into this section where he's talking. And here's what Jesus says in verse 24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew. So you've got three enemies beating on that house. You've got rain, and you've got floods, and you've got wind, and it's just beating on the house that's been built. And the Bible says, it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not. So there's your comparison. Two kinds of disciples. One kind hears what Jesus says and does it. The other kind, although they're familiar with what Jesus said, they don't listen. They don't do what he says. That person shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew. The same three enemies, the rain, the floods, the wind, are beating on that house. But that house fell, and great was the fall of it. It was a big disaster, and everybody knew it at the end. I would say that nobody backslides overnight. Nobody backslides in a day. Nobody backslides because of one moment of temptation or one moment of weakness. People backslide when they start to let convictions slide, and they start to let walls come down, and they start to do little things that they never would have done before. A lot of times I think people backslide and get kind of cold in their experience with God because they do something that is so unwise. They begin to look around, and every decision they make, they kind of poll what other Christians are doing. Well, other Christians do this, and they seem to be getting away with it. Or other Christians do this, and it doesn't seem to hurt them. Or I'm better than other Christians. Or I'm doing at least as much as other Christians. And that is a terrible way to guide your Christian life. Because when you're always looking at somebody else, your standard of where you're living gets lower and lower and lower and lower. The truth is, there's always going to be somebody living at a higher spiritual level than all of us, and there's always going to be somebody living at a lower spiritual level than all of us. But the problem with comparing yourself to any of them, even the ones that are doing better, the Bible tells us they that compare themselves among themselves, they're not wise. Why? Because if you compare yourself to some super spiritual giant, what's going to happen is you're going to feel so condemned, you're going to feel like giving up. But the other problem is just as bad. If you compare yourself to somebody that's weaker than you, that's not doing as much for God as you think you're doing, you're going to feel kind of smug and maybe even a little self-righteous. And so both ways, when we compare ourselves to somebody else, we lose. The only standard for your Christian life is right here. The Bible guides what we do, and the Bible is our standard of behavior. And so this is why Jesus is teaching. You've got to run your life according to my words, my commandments. If you obey my words, you're like the guy that built his house upon the rock. If you ignore my words, if you don't listen, you're like the guy that built his house, his whole life, his whole spiritual existence on the sand. The same enemies come at both houses, and one stands and one falls. That's why Jesus does this in Matthew chapter 7. Jot these down if you've got a pen. Jesus talks about two kinds of disciples. We're not going to take time to read the passages. I'll just explain it, but you've heard this before. In verse 13 and 14, Jesus talks about two ways, a narrow way and a broad way. Two ways. You've heard that before. Straight is the gate and narrow is the way, and few there be that find it, because there's another broad road. The broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be that go therein. So there's this broad way that many people are on. Many people find it acceptable to walk that way. But then there's this narrow way that's very difficult. And few find that way. Jesus is not comparing. This is something people preach sometimes. He's not comparing this big wide road that goes to hell and all the sinners are on that, and this little narrow way that all the saints are on. He's not talking about that. He's talking about two kinds of disciples. There's a lot of disciples that just kind of live by the status quo. Many find that way. But because they're not really anchored in the words of Jesus, they may have known about him, they may have had an experience with him, but then they just slack off and slide. They're on a broad way. But there's a few disciples. Comparatively, it's a few. They find this narrow way. It's a little restrictive on the narrow way. The very word in the Greek means something that's confined or pressed in. But that doesn't bother these people. They don't feel restricted by the word of God. They don't feel bound by the commandments of God. They rejoice that they found this narrow way that pleases God. And then Jesus in verse 16 through 20, he talks about two trees. Everybody say trees. So you've got these two trees. One tree, they're both trees. They're both alive at some point. But one tree bears good fruit and one tree bears bad fruit. So to bear fruit is a symbol of being a disciple. But one disciple, again, he's not comparing sinner and saint. He's comparing two kinds of disciples. One disciple bears good fruit. Their life matters for God. The other disciple, it's just temporal stuff. It's just earthly stuff. It doesn't matter. And then finally, he gets to where we want to spend a little bit of time tonight for the next 40 minutes or so. He gets to verse 24 through 27, and Jesus begins to talk about these two houses that we just read about. That's where we want to spend our time. These two houses are both built by people who expect to live in them. They're both built by people who use the same sorts of building materials. But the problem with these two houses is one is founded upon a faulty foundation. It's on shifting sand. And the other is founded upon a rock. And so these are two kinds of disciples. Jesus didn't waste his breath when he was talking about this. He gave us this so we would look at it and it would be provoking to our thoughts, which kind of disciple am I? So let's look at what Jesus teaches us about the Christian life, about our spiritual life. Number one, every person in their spiritual life is building a house. You're building your spiritual life by how you act, how you react, how you obey, how you disobey when it comes to the Word of God. Every person is building a house. Now, in Scripture, and I gave you the references here, the word house can be used to represent a person's own life, that your life is your house and you're building it. And Jesus refers to that in his parables. But your house can also be your family. It's very important that when you guide your family and you lead your family and you, kind of grow up your family, that you operate by scriptural principles, because you're building a house. The place you live in is kind of immaterial when it comes to spiritual things. You may live in a nice dwelling. You may live in kind of a cheaper dwelling, or a dwelling that maybe is kind of temporary and you wish you had something better. You know what? That's not what makes your home. The real house you're building is not the building you live in. It's the spiritual building that you're building around your family. That's why it's so important, as we raise our children and as we interact one with another, that we're doing it according to biblical principles. And then finally, this is beautiful, 1 Peter. Peter begins to talk about the church itself, and he compares the church to a house. So whatever sense you mean it, the house of your spiritual life, the house of your family, or the house of the local church, there are principles in Scripture that guide us as we build a house. We are building a house right now. Right now we're in, there's Ethan, he's getting excited about the risen business again. By the way, that's what I started to say. Eric, stick your head in for just a minute. It's okay. Tomorrow is Eric and Annette's 10th anniversary. That's what I started to say, and I forgot. Amen. Now you can go deal with Raisin Boy. We're building a little addition there. We've been in constant construction for like 14 years here. We just keep moving it around. It goes to the washrooms, then it goes to the youth chapel, then it goes downstairs to Sunday school, then it goes to the office wing, and it just moves around. It's just constant chaos and building and whatever. And we hope most of it has been invisible to you. This part is not going to be so invisible, since we've blocked off the main entrance of the church. But we're building. And when you build according to certain principles. Right now they're working on the part that goes in the ground. Nobody is going to talk about that once they fill that hole in. But right now, that's very important. Nothing else that we do after we get that part done would matter if that part's not done right. And we've had to change it. Pastor Jack knows way more about this than I do, but we had to widen the foundation a little bit because of what's going to be resting on it. And so we went back and forth with plans with Brother Darcy Dudley in the city and whatever. And if Darcy didn't have all the clout and knowledge and know-how that he does, we'd be in a mess. So we're thankful for him. But we're getting that done. We found a little issue the other day. I was in Madagascar, which is good, because if I was here, I would be a pain in everybody's whatever, and a thorn in their side. That's what I should say. Should remember the thorn one instead of pain. But they were working out there, and that nice central pillar that we've walked up the stairs by, and you know, whatever, it's really, really nice, except the foundation of that was never done properly. And when we uncovered it all, there's not enough foundation to support that pillar. And what was there, they could flake away with their finger. It just was done quickly or cheaply or however. And that's why we've had a problem with those steps kind of heaving and cracking and whatever. Well, we're going to fix that. But the whole problem with foundations is, if they're not done right, they get buried and people don't even realize that there's an issue. And we wonder why we have problems later, but there's no firm, proper foundation underneath. So whether you're building your life or your home, your family, if you're building a church, if you're building your character, if you're building society, the Bible principle is that we have to build very, very carefully on that foundation. Now, let's read this scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10. Paul says, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. Now watch this. I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed, be very, very careful how he builds thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay. In other words, no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So you've got to get the foundation right. The foundation's got to be Jesus and what he's done for you. And then if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Whatever you build on that foundation, some things are good. Gold, silver, precious stones. Some things are temporary. They don't matter. Wood, hay, stubble, they just burn up. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So hopefully we all start with the right foundation, Jesus Christ, but then we have to build on that foundation. And the way we build and what we build will be judged when we get to heaven. Christians are not judged as to whether they get into heaven or not. If you are a child of God and you've been born again of the water and the Spirit, you've experienced the new birth, you're going to heaven. But when we get there, we're going to be judged, the Bible says, for the words we speak, for the deeds that are done in the body. So we will have a judgment. It's not a judgment as to whether we get there. You're already there. It's called the judgment seat of Christ, and God will judge what we built on this wonderful foundation that we have. So every person in Jesus' parable is either a wise builder, they're building good things on that foundation, or they're a foolish builder, and they're building just, it's not that they're building even bad things, it's just that they're building temporal things, earthly things, things that don't matter. It's just a waste of their time and energy. So let's flip the page, if you would, and let's go to the heart of this lesson. There are three major parts of a house, three major parts of any structure. There's three major parts out here. There's three major parts of a house, and so here they are. Letter A. The first thing you've got to have for a house is that proper foundation. It's got to be a proper foundation. Hebrews chapter 6 says, "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection." Now, the writer of Hebrews is not saying, ignore the principles of the doctrine of Christ. He's not saying, forget them. He's not saying, let's leave them in the sense of, let's never look at them again or let's not value them. He's saying, leave them in the sense of, let's get beyond them. Let's not forever play in the sandbox of the Christian life and never grow up. Let's get beyond them. If I was going to Prince Edward Island, I would drive from Fredericton and I'd drive probably through Moncton and I would say, now I'm leaving Moncton and I'm continuing on to Prince Edward Island. That doesn't mean I ignore Moncton or I'll never be back or I'll never revisit it. It just means if I'm going to get to Prince Edward Island, I've got to leave Moncton. I've got to go through it and get beyond it. And that's the sense in which he means it. Let's not forever just kind of rehearse the principles and rehearse the basics. And, you know, when Pastor Jack preaches Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, that's not for you. That's for somebody here that's never experienced the new birth. That's what we're preaching for. Your job is to worship and pray and amen and get excited about that. But you don't have to experience that over and over again. We need the meat of the word so we can grow. And so the writer here says, let's move beyond those principles. And here's some of the principles he lists. Let's not lay again the foundation of repentance unto dead works, or from dead works, and a faith toward God, and the doctrine of baptisms and laying on of hands and resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment. What is he saying? He's saying, you know what? We've got the basics. We understand the basics. Now let's grow and let's go on and let's learn the meat of the Word of God. So that's what he's saying, but I want to take his example. He says, what is the foundation? The principles of the doctrine of Christ, all of these things, repentance and baptisms, and all of that is the beginning. So that's why we would say that the proper foundation, if you want to write this word down, is salvation. Your proper foundation for a Christian life is Bible salvation. Nothing else matters. There are tens of thousands of church members in New Brunswick that go to churches that don't teach the proper way to get saved. They have a religion, they do nice things, they do good works, but nobody is getting saved because nobody's obeying Scripture as it was taught by the first century church. So they're just kind of doing a 21st century religion. And without that foundation, they can build this incredible kind of a life. They can build this incredible kind of a church program. They can build this incredible system of good works and kindness and neighborliness and helping other people. But it all is going to fall when the storms come and when judgment comes because it's not built on the right foundation. Your foundation is what the Bible teaches about salvation. You've got to have that part of the house down first. The second part of the house, letter B, is the actual structure of the house. You don't just build a foundation. That's all in the ground. You start to build the structure. And in the next few weeks, we're going to start to see the structure come out around there. And there's going to be some beautiful doors and glass and whatever. And it's going to be a really nice place. And we like that because it keeps all of you from kind of falling and breaking your skull on those icy steps that we used to have. And so we're thrilled to bid them goodbye. If you miss the steps, they're over in the field. Go over, grab yourself a chunk. It'd be like, the Berlin Wall. You can have a piece. You can put it in your library. It's just right over there in the field. Help yourself. If you'd take all of it, we'd be thrilled. It'd be great. Just decorate your house with it. It's wonderful. But we're thrilled about that. And by the way, now, this has got nothing to do with a lesson. This is not even spiritual. In fact, this is probably very carnal. But none of us are so young that a handrail in the winter wouldn't help us. Especially if you're a senior. I know that you're wonderful and you're not aging and that you're independent and that you've got lots of energy and you put all of us to shame. I know that. But please, in the winter, don't go skipping across the parking lot. Please be careful. Act your age. Never mind. Okay, now that's pastoring. Okay. We're scared. We don't want you to fall. Okay. Okay, so proper structure. Everybody say structure. We are now officially back to the Bible. Proper structure. You've not only got to have a proper foundation, you got to have a proper structure. And Noah's Ark illustrates that truth. God gives Noah instructions on how to build the ark, and it had to be built exactly according to pattern. Only those that were in the framework of the ark that Noah built exactly according to pattern, only they survived the flood, and the flood went for 40 days. Moses' tabernacle is another example of the importance of structure. God gave Moses the pattern for the tabernacle, and he built it exactly according to the pattern. It was a framework that was holding together. It was taken down and assembled, many thousands of times as they journeyed through the wilderness, and always put together exactly the same. And it survived the storms of the wilderness and all of that. And for 40 years, they wandered. For 40 days, they survived the flood in the ark. For 40 years, they wandered in the wilderness, and the tabernacle was their worship place. Exodus 25 talks about that tabernacle. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. According to all that I show thee, Moses, watch this, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall you make it. Moses, you got to do it exactly like this because structure is important. Pattern is important. Now, 40 is the number of testing in Scripture. Jesus was tempted in the wilderness 40 days. So it's the number of testing. And God tests our obedience here. Now think with me. We've already got the foundation laid, and the foundation is our salvation. But now we're into a different phase of the Christian life. We don't need to get saved again. We're already saved. We don't need to be born again. With all respect to the song, we don't need to be born again. We just need to be born again once. And if you've been born again, you enter into the new phase of the Christian life. Justification is what happens when you're born again. God takes your sins away. He makes it just as if you'd never sinned. You have a clean record before him. Now you enter into another phase of the Christian life, and we call this holiness or sanctification. It's the next phase. This is the growing phase. Every disciple, it's God's will that you grow up in him. And this is where God starts to lay this on you, and it's different. God starts to give you commandments. God starts to, through your pastor, through your Bible reading, through his Spirit, he starts to put things on your heart, and he starts to give you some rules, and he starts to give you commandments. And that's not God burdening you. God doesn't burden you with his commandments. He blesses you with his commandments. This is a cheap reference to a grandchild who's over here because I have to try to insert her every once in a while in a sermon now. This is the new role of pastor or AKA grandbuddy. Clara doesn't have any rules right now. In fact, my observation of Emily and Ryan is that Clara is making all the rules right now. She doesn't have any rules. She sleeps when she wants to sleep. give or take. She eats when she wants to eat, give or take. She's making the rules right now. There will come a point when she gets a little older, and as she gets a little more mature, they start to make the rules. Do they start to make the rules as she grows and starts to understand and they can say no and she understands that? Are they doing those rules? Are they making those rules to hurt her? Did you make rules for your kids to hurt them? No, you make rules to bless them and to train them and to raise them up. And so that's what God does. God's family's the same. When God gives you a commandment and God gives you a principle and you see in his word that he's asking for this or that, that's not to hurt you. That's not to burden you. That shouldn't chafe you and make you mad at God. That should be a compliment to you. I'm growing up, and so God has given me some of these principles to live by. And that is the structure that we build on the foundation. The foundation is your new birth experience. The foundation is your salvation. But the structure is God's commandments. That's what the structure is. And there's a lot of Christians today that want to be saved, but after they get saved, they don't want one thing to do with God's commandments. They just want to ignore it. They want to have God forgive their sins and bless their life and heal their body and help their family, but they don't want to do anything in return for that. And that is not this church, and that is not any of us, and that's not the way we teach it or preach it, because it's not the way the Bible teaches or preaches it. The Bible teaches that if you've been saved and you know you've been saved and you're grateful to God, out of that gratitude, you will delight to obey the commands of God. God doesn't hit you over the head every 5 minutes and say, you got to. No, it's a spirit that gets in you that I want to. And that's the difference. And so this is the structure that we're building. It's the commandments of God. So the foundation is our salvation. The structure is God's commandments in our lives. And then we have a third part, because it's really nice to have the structure and the foundation, but then you need a covering over top of it. That's the third part of the house. Without a covering, it could be functional. Noah's Ark would have functioned without the top on, but they'd have had to do a lot of bailing water. They needed a covering. The tabernacle could have functioned, technically, I suppose, without a covering on it, but it would have been open to the elements. So the covering is, it goes over the top of the building. And this covering protects the occupants, and this covering makes it comfortable to be inside. You prefer your house with a roof on top of it. You really do. You may not have even ever thought about that, but that's illumination in Bible study tonight. You really like having the roof on your house, especially in the winter. And so that's God's covering over us. Look at this scripture. This is the tabernacle again. Exodus 26, verse 14. Moses, thou shalt make a covering for the tent of ram skins dyed red, and then put another covering over top of that of badger skins. So that's the outside of the tabernacle. The tabernacle on the outside was covered with these dull, gray, ugly badger skins. It was water repellent, and it kept everything inside dry, and that was the outer covering of the tabernacle. It didn't look very pretty. Nobody was going to rob the tabernacle if they didn't know what was in it, because it didn't look pretty. It looked like a really ugly tent structure. But if you ever went in that door, inside that door, there was gold everywhere. There were beautiful articles of furniture made out of gold. There was beautiful tapestries and linens. And if you looked up underneath the badger skins and the ram skins dyed red, at the very lowest level was fine twined linen. The ceiling in the tabernacle, although it was a tent, was very beautiful. They tell us it was embroidered with all kinds of depictions of angels. It was amazing. But you didn't see any of that from the outside. Outside, it looked very humble and very plain. You didn't understand the riches of the tabernacle until you went inside and took a look from the inside out. That's where you started to understand. The Christian life is the very same. People look at Christians and they think, oh my goodness, what kind of a life is that? And they've got all these rules to live by and whatever. Only when you enter into the door and you get inside a relationship with God and you begin to look around at everything God's done for you and you begin to look at everything God's freed you from and you begin to look at all the consequences of your life that were weighing you down and all of a sudden you're free of all of that and you've got a liberty you never had before, then you understand. You can't understand Christianity from the outside in. You've got to make the decision, and then you get to understand it from the inside out, and that's what the tabernacle shows us. So you've got to have this proper covering over your life. And the covering that comes upon our lives is God's blessing. God blesses us because, number one, we've experienced salvation. The foundation is built. Number two, we're obeying his commandments, and so the structure is there. And when you are when you're a child of God, you've been saved, and now you're obeying God's commandments, you're putting that structure in place, and that's a lifelong building project. God comes in, and he gives you a covering of his blessing, and that's what makes the difference in the Christian life. And so we've got three major parts of this house that we're building. Whether you're talking about a church has a foundation, and it has structure, and it has a covering. Not just physically, but spiritually. We preach the message that gets people saved, but we also preach the message that helps people live, because we've got to be delivered from all of this stuff that's around us in our culture. And then when we preach those two messages, the message of justification that saves us, the new birth, and the message of sanctification or holiness that grows us up and builds structure in our life, then God's blessing covers over that whole thing. And so that's the paradigm that we're looking at when we talk about building. Now, I just want to finish with this little part, because if you think the devil is going to let you do that unharmed, unopposed, and unmolested, you don't understand. The devil doesn't want you to live for God. He doesn't want you to succeed in living for God. He doesn't want our church to thrive and grow and have an impact. He doesn't want that. And so he's always opposing. And so the devil sends these enemies. And I want to go back to Jesus' words. He said there's three major tests of a house. Three tests are going to come against these houses. Whether we're talking about your personal life, whether you're talking about your family, or whether you're talking about the church of the living God, three tests are going to come, and they're going to rattle and shake everything around you. Sometimes you're going to feel like, my goodness, it's rough, and it will be rough for a while. But hang in there, because God's going to see you through. So let's talk about this. Number one, the first test, Jesus said the floods came. Floods test the foundation. Those waters lap up against that foundation. And you remember from Jesus' parable, when the floods came, the house that wasn't built on a foundation, it fell. Only a house that has a proper foundation can stand. But the floods come and they test the foundation. In today's society, the enemy sends all kinds of tests against the foundation. What's our foundation? Our foundation is the message of salvation. The enemy would love for us to have questions about that. He would love to oppose that. He'd love for people to embrace a different version of salvation. So they think they're saved. They go to church and they think they've obeyed. They go to church and they think they're a Christian, but they never do anything biblical about it. Because at the end of the day, at the judgment, the thing that matters is not what your pastor says or what your denomination says. It's only what the Word of God says. And so the devil would be very happy to have a bunch of people going to churches that don't really preach the Bible way to get saved. And they think they're fine. And they think they're good. And they think they're saved. And the devil sits back and he laughs. And he just keeps sending that flood of all kinds of opposition against the foundation. Because here's what the devil knows. It doesn't matter how many good works you build on a wrong foundation. It doesn't matter what kind of religious experience you have on a wrong foundation. It doesn't matter how big a church you could build on a wrong foundation. It doesn't matter how many great things you do around the world on a wrong foundation. Because at the end of the day, when the flood comes, the foundation's going to cave and everything collapses, and the devil has thousands of people in that situation right now. Because they think they're okay.
The Bible says in Isaiah 59, so shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. You know this part. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. A standard was a rallying cry. It was a banner hoisted in the air. And a standard basically said, hey, over here, the enemy's coming. Let's fight here. And the standard bearer would hold that flag up and everybody would rush to that spot to fight. And we are still a church that when we preach the New Testament message, we always end the right way. We don't end with, you know, you need to accept the Lord as your personal Savior. I don't pick fights with that phrase, but that phrase is not in the Bible. At best, that phrase represents repentance, asking Jesus to forgive you of your sins. But the Bible teaches us a different rallying cry for the end of that message. When we preach the gospel message that Jesus died and he was buried and he rose again, that's a powerful, wonderful message that does you absolutely no good unless you obey it. And so we still hold up the Bible standard of full salvation and we say the way you obey repent, or the way you obey the death of Jesus is you repent, and the way you apply the burial of Jesus is you're buried in baptism, and the way you get the resurrection power of Jesus is you get the resurrection power of the Holy Ghost. And we still hold up that standard, and it doesn't matter who doesn't like it or who pushes against it or how much the enemy fights it. That's the only thing that changes people's lives. All you need to do is travel cross culturally just a little bit, and when you see that this thing works in any culture, in any country, in any situation, here we've got comfort, we got nice seats, and we've got electricity, and we got a little bit of air conditioning in the summer, and we got some nice heat in the winter, and we got all of these conveniences and comfort. But testimony, you can go into the back of Africa, you can go into the island of Madagascar, and you can put everybody in a big open tabernacle with the back end kicked out, and when they preach the gospel, those people respond in obedience, and the same Holy Ghost that fills people here by the dozens fills them by the thousands over there. And that's incredible to me. And it's because we're preaching the right foundation. Everybody say floods. Floods test the foundation. What are the floods? The floods are Satan's attacks. We concentrate on the devil attacking us. You know, the big battle is not the devil attacking you. The big battle is the devil attacking the gospel message that we preach, getting us to think, well, we don't really need to witness because really everybody's kind of going to heaven anyway. Everybody is not going to heaven. That is the most pervasive lie at most funerals that you would ever go to. Everybody's not going to heaven. People that have obeyed the gospel that Jesus Christ delivered to his apostles and his apostles delivered it to us, those are the people that are going to live forever in the New Jerusalem with Jesus. And I'm so grateful and so thankful and almost in awe and maybe a little bit of shock that I get to be one of the people that heard that message and obeyed that message, and I'm saved, and I know that I'm saved. And I don't know that I'm saved because I woke up feeling religious. I don't know that I'm saved because I woke up feeling good. I know that I'm saved because I've obeyed the word of God that was delivered at the beginning. And so I'm not proud about it. I'm not boastful about it. I'm so grateful for it. I feel so humbled by it that I'm in the family of God and I'm going to heaven. And so the real battle is not the devil attacking my health or the devil attacking my house or the devil attacking my car or the devil attacking my job or the devil attacking my peace of mind. The big battle is the devil trying to attack the foundation, the gospel of Jesus Christ that is preached. So when your preachers have enough boldness to stand up, and in a society that says everybody's right, everybody's going to the same place, and you get a man of God or a woman of God that dares to stand up and say everybody's not going to the same place, we got to obey the word of God. You need to pray God's anointing on them, and you need to thank God for them, and you need to listen to them, because the most important thing that you can ever do for your life or your family or this city is to preach the foundation. Oh my goodness. So floods, they test the foundation. The devil is constantly going to send a flood of attack against the foundation. That's the real battle. Don't preach the gospel. Preach prosperity, preach blessing, preach happiness, preach all kinds of stuff, but just don't preach the gospel, because you can have a great marriage and go to hell. You can have good finances and go to hell. You can have peace of mind and go to hell. But if you've obeyed the gospel, it doesn't matter if your little life is falling apart. When this is all over, you're going to step foot on streets of gold. So that's the foundation. That's the message that we preach. And that's the big battle. That's the one the devil attacks. But then there's another test of a house, and it's winds. Everybody say the wind. And the wind tests the structure. Look at this scripture, Ephesians chapter 4. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every what? Every wind of doctrine. By the sleight of man, like somebody doing one of those carnival games, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Now, there are many, many voices, even within the church today, that say God's commandments. God's commandments are the structure around our life. There are many voices that say God's commandments are no longer necessary, that we've got new revelation and new light. And some people even teach this foolishness, that if it's not a salvation issue, then it's not an issue at all. If you've ever heard the question, well, is it a heaven or hell issue? Is it really a heaven or hell issue? You need to run as far as you can from that question. Because what somebody's asking when they look at the commandments of God and they say, well, yeah, that's in the Bible, but I don't think that's a heaven or hell issue. And the implication they're given is, I don't think we need to bother with that. I don't think we need to obey that. What they're really saying, if you really get to the bottom of their question, they're saying, you know, Pastor, these lifestyle things that you people practice and teach, and is that really a heaven or hell issue? Here's what they're asking. How close can I get to the edge and live on the edge? How close can I get to the world and still be saved? What a terrible idea to ask that question and let that question guide your life. Your real question should be, how far can I get away from the edge so that I've got some space to protect me as I live for God? And that's why John in the New Testament said, your commandments, O Lord, they're not grievous unto me. They don't upset me. They don't mess me up. They don't give me a bad attitude. I just got it. That if God's given me a commandment, then that's to protect me from falling over the edge back into the world. And so winds of doctrine, they test this structure. So really the winds that are coming are false doctrines. There's all kinds of false doctrines today. And you will notice that a lot of the people that are teaching false doctrine, very few people, there's a few, but very few people are teaching a stricter way. There's a few. And you could rightfully probably call them Pharisees. They trust in their own goodness and their own rule-keeping, and that's just foolishness, because you could keep 1,000 rules for 1,000 years, and it's not going to make you one bit more righteous. It's because of what Jesus did on the cross that we're saved. But most people, probably 98 or 99% of the people that are teaching false doctrine, watch what they're teaching. Almost every time, it's, this is an easier way. This is an easier way. This doesn't demand as much commitment. This won't make you so odd in the world or among your friends or at work. Almost everybody that's teaching something different than what the Word of God teaches, they're trying to teach this easier way to live for God. I don't need it easier. I need it actually more consistent. That's where my battle is. You know, some days you do really good, and some days it's like, oh my goodness, I'm struggling today. I need consistency. I don't need easy. I need consistent. And so when God gives me commandments, my job is to figure out how I can more consistently obey His commandments. I don't need days that I'm way up on the mountaintop and all I'm doing is getting ready for a crash. You know, super, super high. high, super, super low. Super high, super low. Super high, super low. I don't need that kind of life. I need a life where every day I'm walking in the Spirit and I'm not fulfilling the lust of the flesh and I'm being consistent for God. And that's better than superstar, temporary spirituality any day of the week. And the devil doesn't like that, so he sends false doctrine, and that false doctrine attacks the structure. You don't need to worry about that. You don't need to worry about a holy life. Oh, yeah, they used to teach that in Pentecost, but they were wrong. They really didn't understand, and we've got new revelation about that. You need to beware of all of those voices. The devil sends those voices, false doctrine, to attack the structure. They're the winds of false doctrine. And finally, the covering, and this might hit on a little practical note for some of you, because I don't really think we've got many people in the core of our church sitting in Bible study on a Wednesday night that are letting the devil blow out the foundation or blow down the walls of structure with false doctrine. I don't think there's too many. We always need to be careful. We always need to be on the alert, but I don't really think that we've got many people that, you know, that's their struggle. This might be your struggle. When you have the right foundation, you're saved, you're a child of God. And when you've built the right structure on that foundation, you're living the commandments of God, you're doing everything you can to please God and live for God consistently. God puts a covering of blessing over your life. And the covering is God's blessing. And I get phone calls and emails and have conversations with many of you through the run of a month or so, and it's amazing God's blessing on so many of you. Some of you have jobs that you probably wouldn't have had if it hadn't been for the blessing of God. Some of you have things, wonderful things happening in your family that wouldn't be happening without the blessing of God. And so the blessing of God is this covering. It protects us. And like a roof, a covering makes it way more comfortable to be in a building. It's wonderful when the covering's over our life. It's wonderful when we're consciously, tangibly feeling the blessing of God. But our problem in North America is that we equate the blessing of God too much with our comfort level. And so if everything's going good, we feel blessed. But you let one thing get out of place and one thing mess up and one thing's not too easy, and we feel like we're no longer blessed. And really, we're not dealing with God letting us down. We're letting our North American sense of comfort let us down, and we feel like God's not being fair. So let's talk about this. Everybody say rains. The rains test that covering. You've got rain pouring down, and they're going to test that covering. Isaiah chapter 4, verse 6, there shall be a tabernacle for a shadow in the daytime from the heat and a place of refuge. And for a covert, a covering from storm and from rain. That's our covering. And rains consistently test the covering. And in life, here's what happens. The rains come, and they put that covering of blessing to the test. And sometimes there's a leak in the roof of blessing, and we feel like, I'm getting wet here, God. Sometimes it feels like God's removed part of the covering for a while. And we're struggling. So I would say, and this is a little subjective, but I would say the rains that test the covering of God's blessing are life's trials. It's Satan's attacks that test your foundation of salvation. It's false doctrine that tests the structure. But it's life's trials that test the covering of God's blessing. Life's trials come, and when trials come, it seems to like block our sense of, God, where are you? I'm no longer covered. I'm no longer blessed. God, I'm hurting. I'm worried. I'm frantic. I'm fretting. And it's not really the case. It's just that we're in a trial. And when we're in a trial, our feelings get all out of whack. God doesn't get all out of whack. Your salvation is still intact. You're living for God. Your holiness is still intact. The only thing that gets out of whack is your feelings. And when life's trials come, your emotions are the most dangerous thing in your life. Because a trial comes and hits you in the face, And if you're not careful, your emotions can make you question God. Your emotions can make you question your salvation. Your emotions can make you question if I'm even doing this Christian life properly. And all it is the reins beaten down on that covering of God's blessing. And every once in a while, feel like there's a hole in the roof and the rain got to you, and it just, your feelings get out of whack. In the same way that Satan attacks our salvation, and in the same way that false doctrine attacks God's commandments, in the very same way, life's trials attack our sense of God's blessing. And so we have to learn how to properly build. Our little building project will be over in a couple of months or 3 months, we hope, and nobody will ever notice after that. We'll come in every day and we'll walk through the doors and we'll come in and we'll get used to the new look and the extra space and the nice steps, and we'll get used to it and it'll become old to us. But it all started with a foundation and then a structure built on the foundation and then a covering over the structure. And no matter what you're building, whether it's your life or your home, whether it's your marriage in the fear of God, or whether it's us building this church together, we always got to have the same thing. The foundation of salvation never changes. It will not change. The structure of obeying God's commandments and listening to God's commandments and not fighting against God's commandments, that structure never changes. And God's covering of blessing, that never changes. Our perception changes. God, I don't feel very blessed today. Do you realize the fact that you're sitting here conscious, breathing air into your body? You are blessed today, no matter what else happens to you today. And so we are blessed. We're covered by God's blessing. So one last question, and we'll close and pray, and we're going to have a very important ECC meeting, and so Pastor wants to get out of the way so they can do that. Very important, that outreach we're doing. What is the difference between that wise disciple and a foolish disciple? What's the difference between a wise disciple that builds this right and a foolish disciple that builds it wrong? This is Jesus' whole point in Matthew chapter 7. It's why he tells about the two roads, one narrow, one wide. It's why he tells about the trees, one bearing bad fruit, one bearing good fruit. It's why he tells about two houses, one built on a foundation that's good, one built on a foundation of sand and it falls. Jesus is always coming back to this point. That the difference between a wise disciple and a foolish disciple. Jesus is not comparing sinners and saints. He's comparing a disciple who's going to succeed and a disciple who's going to fall flat on their face. What's the difference? Here's the difference. James chapter 1. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, because if you do that, you're deceiving your own selves. If anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like unto a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. He beholds himself, he goes his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. He gets up in the morning, he walks into the bathroom, he looks in the mirror, he goes, ugh. And he walks away, he doesn't comb his hair, he doesn't wash his face, he doesn't shave, he doesn't brush his teeth, and he goes to work, and he forgets. So the mirror didn't help him at all. He looked at it, but he didn't pay attention. Jesus said it's the very same thing, and James picks up on this, and he amplifies it in his epistle. He said, if you look into the mirror of the Word of God, and you look, but you don't pay attention, you're just like that man. And it's crazy to look into the Word of God and then never obey it. It's crazy to look into the Word of God and never do anything about it. That's just a hearer of the Word. But don't you just be a hearer of the Word. Get a hunger for the Word. Be a doer of the Word, because those are the people that are blessed. So what's the difference between a foolish disciple who ends up in disaster and a wise disciple that ends up succeeding and living for God? It's just this: obedience. No matter what. Don't just write down the word obedience. Write obedience, comma, no matter what, exclamation mark. That's the difference. Jesus says it, James says it, Paul says it, Peter says it. Every writer in the New Testament basically tells us that if we will have a heart that obeys the word of God, and we'll do that no matter what, no matter what floods come, no matter what winds come, no matter what rains come, we obey God. It's obedience no matter what. They invented a little bracelet some of the young people wore for a while. WWJD. What would Jesus do? I haven't even taken time to work out this acronym in my head, so please forgive me, but I'd like to invent a bracelet that's like, forget that. What are you going to do? We already know what Jesus did and what he's going to do. The question isn't what's Jesus going to do. The question is, what are you going to do? And a successful disciple is somebody who obeys no matter what. Hope the word of God blessed you and helped you tonight, strengthened you. I'd like you to stand with me. We're going to pray, and then we're going to get out of the way and let them do this very important meeting. Let's pray one more time about our weekend with Brother Stone King and about One Church's weekend with Tim Green. We want God to show up in his power. And Brother Stone King's going to be ready. I was chatting with him today. He gets here tomorrow night at 6. He'll be well-rested and ready to go. This man died about 11 years ago. God raised him from the dead. This is the guy that's been had the privilege of speaking at the UN Assembly just a few months back. And he's actually been at the UN a couple of times since then, working with Brother Art Wilson. Amazing things are going to happen. Just the stories Brother Stone King is going to tell this week are worth coming every service. It's going to be phenomenal, and God's going to show up in his power. Let's lift our hands, and let's not do a dismissal prayer right now. Let's pray over the weekend right now and ask God to meet us here this weekend. Lord Jesus, thank you, God, for Bible study. Thank you, God, for church. Thank you, Jesus, for the privilege of living for you. And now, God, we pray one more time your blessing on this weekend. Jesus, we're praying that you will show up in your power and your glory, that your name will be lifted high, that your power will be seen, that lives will be changed, that people will be filled with the Holy Ghost, that people will be healed and delivered and saved from sin this weekend. God, I pray a great anointing on Brother Stone King to minister. But Jesus, I pray a great anointing on us to minister. Help us to minister in the service as we worship and sing. Help us to minister in the altar as we pray and intercede. Help us, God, this weekend to be the church that you've called us to be. Let your glory be seen in the city of Fredericton and in CCC this weekend, I pray. Jesus, I pray for Justin and Dan and One Church and for their revive meeting this week. God, let your spirit be felt and let your glory be seen in Halifax. We pray in that little sister church that we're trying to birth in that great city. God, use those great men and use Tim Green and use the people that are gathered there. And God, let your glory be seen and let this weekend matter for eternity. And we pray it and we dare to believe it and we believe we're going to see it in the name of Jesus. And we'll give you all the praise for it and all the honor because of it and all the glory throughout it, because it's all because of you. It's all because of you. It's all because of you. And we give you glory in advance and we give you praise in advance for what you're going to do. And we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. As an amen, let's lift up one great shout of praise to the Lord before we walk out the door. That's our amen tonight. That's our so be it, God. That's Jesus. We're expecting you to show up, and we're anticipating what you're going to do, and we are excited about it. Hallelujah. I worship you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. I give you praise and honor and glory, and I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.